All right, moments ago, there was
history.
A meeting that made history.
Look at how comfortable Joe looks.
On the left is Joe Lockhart, former White House press secretary under President Bill Clinton. On the right, former independent counsel Kenneth Starr. The men meeting for the very first time, and they join us now on live television to talk about, oh, what happened 20 years ago, oh, what's happening today. But first, let me just start with that moment, Joe. I mean, did you ever think you would be face-to-face with Judge Starr? How did that feel?
I look forward to it.
Okay, I read body language.
Yeah, exactly.
And that was not the most comfortable exchange. Was there a time 20 years ago where you thought if you ever saw him, you'd punch him in the nose?
I never thought that. I thought I might yell at him, but I doubt I'll do it this morning. I described it as, we came away from it, as kind of a bad surprise party.
That's awful.
Judge, your take on it.
Totally pleasant. You know, I like people. So, Joe, very nice to meet you.
Very nice to meet you.
And thanks for not punching me out.
You're a people person.
Yes.
That's what they say. So, Judge Starr, let me ask you about the news this morning. We watched yesterday Judge TSL's federal judge, you've been in that role before, give a sentence that was far below the federal guidelines for the crimes that Paul Manafort was convicted of, 47 months in prison. Your reading of that sentence?
He was tempering justice with mercy. Here is a 67-year-old defendant who's obviously not in the best of health. And Judge Ellis made a very interesting comment about federal prisons. And I've been in a number as a visitor of federal prisons. People die, not through terrible things happening, but just it's a very stressful place. And so I think Judge Ellis, who's been on the bench for 30 years, understood that. And I think he also just said to Bob Mueller's prosecutors, this is really excessive. What you're seeking is really excessive. That's one judge's view.
There are two aspects of that. Number one, you say it's really tough. Federal prison is, well, it's equally tough for young black men who get convicted of crimes.
Absolutely.
That people don't think, you know, or think, why are they being convicted of crimes and getting far bigger sentences than aging white guy convicted of tax fraud when that is a crime?
Each situation has to be analyzed by the judge as opposed to, I'm going to do a lot of comparisons here. That's why you have a pre-sentencing report. The pre-sentencing report looks at the person's entire life. So you're right. Are there disparities? That's the reason we have sentencing guidelines. But it's also the reason that Congress has seen fit to give judges the ability. It's reviewable, so we'll see. If the prosecutors decide, you know, we're going to appeal this downward departures, they have the authority to do that.
Yeah, the discrepancy, obviously, between street crimes and white-collar crimes this morning is getting a lot of attention, and many people feel that the judge was too lenient, one of whom is Monica Lewinsky, who's pointing out the sentence that he got. She says, yep, I had been threatened with 27 years for filing a false affidavit and other actions, trying desperately to keep an affair private. Do you see your point?
Of course I see the point. No one should, in fact, have to face these horrible sentences. And so, but who provides the framework for the criminal sentence? The Congress of the United States. I think we have overcriminalization of the laws, and I think many of the sentences are much too harsh, and there are too many people sitting in prison. Now, that's one person's view, but it's increasingly, as I think we're seeing politically, the view of the American people and the members of Congress saying, we need to recalibrate. We've gotten carried away with these very draconian sentences.
But who was threatening her with 27 years for filing a false affidavit?
Oh, there may have been a conversation. I did not, but we'll see. That's the first I've heard of that, to be honest.
Joe, when you look at all this, well, okay, you're skeptical.
I'm skeptical of that only because it's been reported widely. It's in Monica Lewinsky's book. It's in a number of interviews. Her lawyer did dozens of interviews where they talked about holding her in a hotel room and telling her that if she didn't tell the truth, she could spend 27 years in jail. So I'm skeptical.
Well, first of all, she was not held in a hotel room. She had the opportunity. So if we want to relitigate that, I'm happy to do that.
Well, let me
finish it, because he just made a very interesting comment. They held her in a hotel room. Absolutely false. That was exactly what she maintained and what her lawyer at the time maintained. And guess what? A district judge, Norma Holloway Johnson, heard what they had to say and said she was not. She was not in custody. She was, in fact, free to leave.
Joe? Yeah. She was 21 years old. She had several older prosecutors sitting in a room threatening her with spending a considerable part of her life in jail. So she may not have been technically in custody, but in this case, I believe her. She felt like she had no choice. She felt like, and it was only when she called her mother, and her mother came down, and her mother talked to a lawyer, that she recognized the idea that she didn't need to be there and she should leave.
It was her impression that she was being...
It was certainly her impression.
With all due respect, utterly revisionist history. She played our prosecutors very effectively. She knew exactly what she was doing.
How could she have known exactly what she was doing when she was 21 years old and hadn't been in that situation
before? She was extremely smart and extremely sophisticated. She kept the prosecutors waiting. Let me wait. let me get my mother down here. And her mother encouraged her to, in fact, cooperate with the investigation. But what she made clear to her mother, and Joe knows this, she was not going to do anything to hurt the president of the United States.
Well, let me just add one other thing, which is there were prosecutors that worked in Judge Starr's office who were extremely uncomfortable with the process. They went on the record afterwards on how uncomfortable they were. And when I look at this and I balance up the statements, I'm going to side with them.
Well, the final thing I would say on this is, let's look at the entire record of what happened. She was at the Ritz-Carlton. She walked around, including on her own. She got a Starbucks. She was able to call the President of the United States, but didn't get through. She was trying to warn the president that this, guess what? You're about to commit perjury. You shouldn't do it. I've committed perjury. Others were being encouraged to commit perjury. This is serious stuff. So, look, she was a very able, smart person who, I think, handled herself extremely well, unfortunately, for the country. That is, she put us off for 6 months.
I mean, listen, it just doesn't add up. If she didn't feel like she was under threat of going to prison, and if she didn't feel like she was being held there against her will because she didn't know her rights, why didn't she, in the hotel room, pick up the phone and call the president of the United States? There's a reason she left that hotel room, because she felt her life was under threat, and that's why several of the prosecutors working in that office were extremely uncomfortable. They thought it was over the line and unethical.
Well, I just totally disagree. And there's been one prosecutor who has made some statements about his own discomfort, but not that anything was over the line. Look, prosecution, we've seen this with the Mueller team. Prosecutors, in fact, use the tools in the tool chest to say, here's what you are facing, and you need to be aware of that. And now it's time for you to make a decision. So are you going to cooperate with the investigation because you have committed a serious crime? And Joe doesn't want to talk about that. She had committed perjury, and she knew she had committed perjury, and she was encouraging others. Now, all of a sudden, when we see people committing perjury in the Mueller investigation, we are outraged, rightly so. But let's now look back at exactly what happened. What happened was the president has a poll done, and he is told that the American people will forgive adultery, but they will not forgive perjury. He was found in contempt of court because of not a perjury, but obstruction of justice. We think obstruction of justice is pretty darn important. So let's look at the bottom line facts of what happened in that investigation with 14 criminal convictions. And Monica, and I wish her well. I hope she does well.
Do you want to go any more comments on this before we?
No, let's move on.
I do think it's interesting, though. I do think it's interesting here that it didn't take much to get this discussion to go back 20 years.
Well, it seems very relevant somehow today. Well, I mean, all of these same things are in play.
And it does beg the question. This is at its base, it was about perjury, but it was about a relationship between a man and a woman. And there was all this, there's all this passion about it. Axios has a story out in the last 24 hours which says, look at what's happening with Russia. Look at what's happening with the Mueller investigation, calling it the biggest political scandal in American history. Is there an issue with proportionality here, Joe, between what's happening now and what happened 20 years ago?
Well, I think Axios makes a great point, because this was, when it came down to it, a question about a personal relationship, however inappropriate, and whether the president was truthful and whether he obstructed justice. The Senate made their decision, and, you know, the country moved on from there. The Axios story, though, points out how much deeper and how much more dangerous and how unprecedented what's going on with President Trump, because it involves a foreign nation trying to influence our election. It involves the president's financial misdeeds, paying hush money to a porn star. It involves so much. It involves the national security advisor getting fired for contacts with the Russians. It involves the president, while in office, writing checks on this hush money. It involves the president potentially putting our national security at risk because of some dealings with the Russians that we've yet to fully understand. So from a proportionality point of view, I think there is no comparison.